with these Kha'Zix bans. To me, this is just a sign that Africa don't want to deal with the champion. Samsung's bans, are they just going to be the three that we've seen every time? It feels like any time someone leaves one of LeBlanc, Camille, or Rengar open, the result is a victory for the blue side team. So given those are penciled in, let's see what Africa want to pinch, because you can be creative with your bans on blue and then just get a champion whose answers inevitably you banned away yourself.
Yep. Well, the Zyra taken off the board yet again here. So Africa going back to that ban like we saw from game one. So if this is the Jace to follow up, they will have the exact same bans.
Malzahar's first pick was the game one ban. Let's see if Samsung gonna get feisty with that LeBlanc, because LeBlanc is the champion right now, is left open. Ryze here would probably be a smart ban. If you banned Ryze, you could basically get Malzahar with no cost as a first pick, because we're expecting that LeBlanc to be the final ban. If you leave Ryze open, you know Crown will take it.
Well, it's gonna be the Chase, so they're just gonna stick to the same bans we saw in game one. So Ryze could be something that comes through for Samsung. Wasn't too impactful in game one, but that just comes off of how snowballed the start of the game was in favor of Africa Freaks.
And look, the Malzahar obviously pre-6 didn't do much, but after 6, I think Africa made a lot of plays with Tucson on the Malzahar, so they will once again elect to take it over Ryze. A lot of teams would disagree with them on that. I think, for example, KT Rolster was really prizing the Ryze for Pawn. Samsung now will take the Ash, but wow, look at this. Cannon okay. Taken away, and Yuvei has played a lot of Kennen. Kennen was, of course, the champion that slayed the dragon that was Someday in that famous KT Rolster win over... Sorry, KT Rolster lost to Samsung that took Samsung over to Worlds. So Yuvei previously has played it the AP style, and now basically he's throwing a gambit to Marin saying, okay, well, what else you got?
Interesting. Sure, Marin has some sort of answer to this somewhere.
Will he just play Rumble? That's the big question here. It's not a fantastic laning matchup early especially. It's a bit of a skill matchup as it develops. Marin usually wins skill matchups on the Rumble. His Maokai is also legendary, and there's another pick that he could try, but Maokai into Kennen, of course, is what caused so many headaches for these teams in previous rounds. Samsung actually get Ryze in their second rotation of picks, so they're going to be pretty damn happy about that.
Yeah, and the Malzahar Varus bot lane coming back through from Africa Freaks with Olaf to boot. So looks like they're just going to be trying to piece together as much of the same composition as they can. The cannon being taken away by Samsung does throw a wrench into that plan. But, I mean, they could just go ahead and get this Cassiopeia again in the mid lane.
Well, the other thing is, right, Achilleos, the plan was winning lanes. And there are lanes that win against cannon. So I think the bigger factor was they had a winning lane than necessarily Marin's a sick cannon player. Because Marin can play quite an interesting champion pool. He's got a bit of an eclectic champion pool of his own and also the meta. So where they go from here is not necessarily constricted. Lise is banned away. Once again on the side of Africa. Okay, Maokai is banned. So this does heavily suggest it's going to be AP cannon rather than AD cannon. And again, is a respect. Guys, missed the stat. I'll say it many, many times this season. In Korea, not including his games in the LPL, on SKTS and SKTK, SKTS and SKTT1, Marin was 29-1 on the Maokai. Karma taken, one of the better choices against Malzahar in lane, so maybe this will force the misfortune support from CoreJJ.
Yeah, I mean, we saw the Karma banned away from them again in game one, so Africa are just really trying to play back to that game one, but the question is, are they going to get the same start, because it was with Ambition coming in on the Rek'Sai. He got absolutely destroyed at his Raptors, couldn't get his red buff, it completely threw off his jungle, and they also got both summoners out of Crown, but things are going to be a little bit different this time. Lee Sin finally showing his face. We saw it banned in game one, not picked in game two. So this is going to shake things up a little bit.
Can they? I don't think they can afford to go Orianna Rumble. So much magic damage if they do. But Orianna will be one of the safer choices to take into the Ryze. No Cassiopeia, because it was one of the bans, the first ban of the second round.
Well, they will take the Orianna, but what's the final piece of the puzzle going to be for Marin? Oh, boy, it's going to get locked in.
Okay, this is his famous Rumble. Marin, again, the story is that, and Smeb has confirmed this, that Marin really taught Smeb how to level up his Rumble. The two kind of befriended each other after Worlds 2015 and, you know, talked via the client during 2016, because Marin was still playing a lot of solo queue on the Korean ladder. lot of magic damage on the side of Afrika Freaks. And they're going to go for the Taric again. This is really interesting. It's been the answer, and I say answer with inverted quotes, to the Malzahar. To me, picking a melee support into Malzahar is never worth the trouble. But basically, if you see a Malzahar walk up at level 6 and you ult preeminently, then okay, the Cosmic Radiance will still apply. Potentially, you'll get it off. But if you're a melee champion and there's, you know, a pink ward in the brush, you're ulting the Taric. There's not going to be that same window. It's going to be flash ult or just ulting someone face checking. So pulling off the Taric seems really difficult, but if you get to the late game, Taric's wonderful.
Yeah. But, I mean, I guess Core JJ, Samsung as a whole, Trace as the coach, does have confidence in this pick going into the Malzahar. We didn't really get to see it in game one, but again, Afrika, they just had such a heavy snowball kick off that game that we don't know how this is going to play out on a more even playing field. So this is their chance to actually make this work.
And they don't have the Cassiopeia versus Ryzen mid lane that has that level 2 advantage. So that same red side invade is now looking so much more risky. But it was the creative start that really propelled Afrika in game one. And let's see if Spirit can find a bit more confidence and a bit more comfortability on playing that Olaf once again. The Olaf looked great in game one. It looked a lot more wayward on the Rek Sai in game two. Different kind of matchup. A bit more of a comfortable one for the Ryze, although Orianna in the late game can certainly do plenty of work against the mid to short range of that Ryze. And
has the Olaf for a ball delivery system. Can just pop the Ragnarok, run straight into the middle of the enemy team.
And then bot lane. Same bot lane as game one. So should go the way of Afrika Freaks, but Malzahar, you know, pretty much waiting for that level 6.
Yeah, we'll see if Ruler can line up the arrows like he did right there in game 2. Really helped lock down a lot of those picks that Samsung got to help them win it. Let's go ahead, get onto the Rift for our third and final game in this first best of 3 of the night, Afrika Freaks versus Samsung. This one's for all the marbles.
Is the first champion revealed here. Notice, not much ability power. Actually, the observers did us a solid and clicked over to the character information during the loading screen. 21 lethality on this cannon. So obviously not flat armor penetration like it once was, but percentage of that is going to be relevant in the early game. Basically tells you that we are going to be seeing AD cannon. Most likely. There is still a world where you go AP cannon. Again, Cuve is more known for his AP cannon. He also went Thunderlords, which again could be AP cannon, but armor pen is there and a bit of magic pen. So interesting stuff here. A lot of information, a lot of questions about Cuve's start. Not confident enough to go the Cull. Cuve fan.
Somebody drawing up the cannon really quickly. They had since first round champion.
Yeah, we do hand out the boards here and pens to create some cheerfuls. While you're watching, you don't have to bring all your fantastic artwork from home.
I mean, as well as Afrika Freaks and Samsung both giving out a plethora of gifts to the fans. There is autographed posters from Afrika Freaks. You can pick your favorite player. They had it autographed, and then you
also
got...
What did you get? Who's your favorite player, Achilles?
You also got the entire team, so I have everybody, but I did take a Marin poster. So
you're a Marin fanboy, huh?
I do have that. Why is he back in Korea? It's been a while, man. Had a really good game one and game two. He's trying to drag the team across the finish line. Just wasn't able to do so.
And now we get something that we were robbed of all of 2016. We get to see, back in Korea, Marin on Rumble.
Yeah.
This was the champion that kind of became a meme about Rumble because he would always push up recklessly at level 2, level 3, and either get ganked or get a solo kill or get a gank for himself. It seemed like all the action played around Rumble's lane, but this time it's actually... I'm going for a walk. He's trying to get information about the path.
Yeah, won't really find anything. And now Haru, pushing in. Thought maybe he would wrap around to the red buff. Definitely could get a kill on the Spirit if he had done so.
So the reason why he did that roam is that he needed to have information to see if he was going to get that level 3 gank that we were talked about. Because it's very easy for Lee Sin to start blue side, path up to top, and kill Rumble. This time it's not going to be the jungler. It's actually going to be Crown.
Crown zipping his way in. Marn goes back in for the trade, gets stunned up. Rune Prison immediately thrown down, and he is just going to die in this exchange. Doesn't even pop the flash, knows that he's dead to rights. First blood hand it over to Cubey, and you can see the smile on his face, not even angry about getting ganked.
This always happens when Marin plays Rumble. Someone at the end of this season needs to make basically a greatest hits of Marin dying or getting a kill between the time of 2 and 5 minutes. Happens every game. It's something for you to look forward to, Achilleos. It was inevitable. This one was creative. It wasn't the jungler. He actually went to check out the jungler and got ganked by the mid laner, so probably going to be shouting at Kuro and comms.
Yep, nicely done by Crown. He used the ghost early on in the game, but it wasn't to get away this time. Now, got to be pretty happy about that. So you can see the tier already coming in. Pre-4 minutes for Crown. That is going to be really bolstering for the Rise to just get his build rolling. Double Doran's Ring and Boots start for Kuro. So Crown definitely going to have the upper hand for now as he clears out these waves and tries to get them underneath the turret in time to deny some CS from Kuro.
So Kull and an Apta. So that does still suggest it's going to be AP cannon. Still protobelt, most likely. Crown's decided he's not interested in laning phase. I haven't seen a mid laner roam this much since Aurelion Sol was around.
He comes down.
Optimistic.
He's really going to find it. Yeah, he gets spotted out, so he's going to have to roam back up. He'll be able to catch the wave by the look of things, so won't be losing out on a whole lot. But, yeah, I mean, just really aggressive roams from Crown looking for these openings. And the ghost is almost back up, so could go for another one in a little bit of time, get some damage in onto Kuro, and mitigate some of that with the command protect.
But sort of freedom he wasn't afforded by the Cassiopeia in game one, so using that newfound freedom to stretch his legs a little bit, see parts of the map he just was denied from seeing in game one.
Taking a tour of Summoner's Rift.
It's pretty much as he left it. Hasn't changed too much since Tuesday.
Well, for now, be down a little bit in CS, but still stacking up that tier as best as he can. Looks like we have actually Haru and Core JJ starting to roam up the river. Might want to go for a bit of an invade. Find Spirit over here at the Raptors. He spikes a big one. Stun does connect. Spirit, not level 6 yet, goes low. Oh, one more hit would have done it. Haru doesn't have the Sonic Wave up to go for the kill.
And while they don't have the same laning pressure with another support, the Bastion Link on the Lee Sin early damage means the Dazzle will connect. He's going for another gank here. Yeah,
finds
Kuro
it on
between
Kuro.
Turrets.
He gets the Sonic Wave. Does he want to go for this and be underneath the tower? And Core JJ has to flash over the wall. Barely stays alive. Pops the heal onto himself.
Ooh,
the
so
slow
low.
Comes through. Flash forward by Kuro. Comes up with the kill. Haru going to have to exit as swiftly as he can. And just a bit of an overstay,
five,
really
six.
Greedy play, and here comes the red carpet laid out for him. Crown getting locked up, kill picked up by Kuro. Cubey too late on the roam down to help turn that one around.
No
has
blast
to just
code
wait
here.
Over the wall. He's actually going to go in with this one, but the command protect is there. Cubey's able to get the answering kill, but all in all, that's a 1-for-2. In favor of a Freak of Freaks.
I don't know about that, Samsung. Haru was channeling some solo queue hijinks right there. You kind of see why they went for the Taric. Because when you leave lane, you get that CC early that you don't have as Lee Sin. And you can potentially just go for those big Thunderlords kills. But the moment that you're level 4, level 5, playing between turrets this early in the game, you know you screwed up. And Rumble, even though he responds very late, consider that Rumble was in lane till what, 2 seconds ago. This is not a place you want to fight against a Rumble. Hits
Hello.
Level 6. Suddenly, there's no exit available for Crown, who dies Crown is old a lot later because he assumed he had a way to get out of lane. And what was looking pretty good for Samsung is now line ball 7 minutes in.
Yep. Still have a bit of a lead from that first blood, as well as a couple CS leads in the top lane and the bottom lane, as Ruler has been out-farming Kramer this entire time. But definitely not where the lead could have been, Bob Smithy. It's much too greedy play coming through.
I mean, the main benefactor is the Rumble, right? Because he was kind of out of the game. He'd gotten taken down.
Sure, yeah.
Now
been
able
to kill
to,
and an assist.
Yeah, kill and assist. Gets Merc Treads to stop the all-in from killing him. Now he can just W away, scrap shield away from the damage that comes after the initial stun, which would be very easy because, of course, the stun duration's even lower with the Merc Treads and can work on his core items. So Marin went from being preyed upon and consistently ganked to back in the game. So big win there for a Freaker, as even though Rumble has that cheap build, a big difference between Rumble getting his items early and, you know, getting his build on a lot later.
Yep. Well, now Samsung Likely just going to slow down the game a bit. Getting a little overzealous in that mid lane play. Play back, just maintain farm. They do have advantages in that regard outside of mid lane. And then Haru can just look for an opportunity to go in, you know, now that he is level 6. The ward hop into a Dragon Strike, try to set up a kill, perhaps in the mid lane, where Crown can immediately follow up with a Rune Prison, or maybe on to Marini yet again, as he doesn't have any vision in the river at the moment. But Haru gets spotted. And Spirit looks like he's just going to take over where he left off and finish off the Scuttle Crab.
It's kind of fun, though, that we had one game where Frico were way ahead 10 minutes in, second game where Samsung were way ahead 10 minutes in, and now third game where it's all even. So we've seen a bit of everything this series.
Got the extremes in the middle ground, so couldn't ask for a better way to finish out the series.
And the best thing about some of these new rosters is that you look at the calendar and it feels like we've got a game that no one can miss every day. You know, when you have five teams that are all to differing degrees really exciting to track, when you include Afrika and Longju with the big three, KT, SKT, and Samsung. And you got the teams that are coming up. We're going to see Kongdu Monster for the first time. If they easily dispatch their opponents in Series 2, then they're going to be on the team that, you know, is on the rise, as you could see by them making the Gyeonggi final.
Yeah, we'll get another look at the ROG Tigers and see how they're able to fare in that matchup. I mean, Kongdu has looked pretty strong. That's going to be the equalizer thrown out by Marin. Slicing Maelstrom comes out from Kube. Gets overheated, so he has to peel back. Kube was dangerously low.
And Marin easily wins that trade. Even though it looked like the equalizer was in a bad spot, it guaranteed that his overheated flame spitter was going to hit for full damage. And obviously, Cannon doesn't really have any defensive stats to speak of.
Kube shows himself. Marin might take that as a sign that something's up. You can see he is playing pretty far back. That's going to be the Sonic Wave coming in. Oh, Haru, not fast enough. Marin reacts, flashes to the other side, and just gets kicked underneath the turret.
I mean, it's such a well-known thing, the insect kick now, that the only way to guarantee the kick is kick flash. And even then, if you're early enough on the flash, you'll still be kicked towards your turret. And the cost here is that showing himself in top means they're going to get this first Drake. It's only a Cloud, not as high priority as the three Infernals we had last time. And notice that Samsung don't actually punish this. The one way to do so would be for Lee Sin to stay top and look for a dive, but with Kennen ult down, with Lee Sin ult down, so it was going to be pretty tricky to pull off, so no cost at all. Just a free objective to Afrika Freaks.
Yep. And Kube still continues to confuse and surprise this build. Haru, though.
He's dead.
Yep, there's nothing you can do against this one. This gets burned out. Marin picks up his second kill. Already has the Haunting, guys. So, a lot more damage on the way.
Fun thing here is that this game in particular feels like an experienced pro jungler against a solo queue jungler. Like, Haru is making some really impressive moves, and I don't think this was necessarily the case in the three wins that he had, but this is him overstaying for pressure. He's like, all right, I lost the Drake. I need to start taking camps. I need to do something. We couldn't get the turret dive. I must make something happen because every action leads to a reaction. Well, unfortunately, his overstay becomes the new action. The reaction is the easy pincer by Marin and Spirit, and there was a kill there. And now Tucson standing in a control ward.
Yeah, that's
he wants
the shockwave. Crown gonna flash away.
Doesn't
pops
have the range.
Yeah, Tucson actually used his flash.
He's optimistic.
Yep. So wasn't able to come up with another grasp. Meanwhile, in bottom lane, Ruler and Core JJ whittling away at that turret. Get good amount of damage in. Haru does find Tucson. That's going to be the arrow coming in from Ruler. Finds it yet again. And Haru is able to pick up the kill. Nicely done by Samsung. They put another one on the board. And those are the picks that they need to play around.
Yeah, Tucson just thought he was safe in the river. And unfortunately, he was not. Sharks were all around this time. It was the Ash Arrow from distance that guaranteed the kill. But I hazard a guess that Haru would have had it one way or the other.
Yep.
Especially with Tucson's flash down.
It's a nice straight shot coming through from Ruler. Didn't have to try to predict any movement. Just knew that he was going to be able to land that one. So nicely done by him to put another on the board. And you can see Spirit now. He has to spend some time in this bottom lane to help out Kramer so they don't lose this turret and give that first brick gold over to Ruler. Flash here by Kuro, but Haru follows up with his own. It's the Sonic Wave, Realm Warp coming through from Crown. Kuro trying to run back, but he just can't do it. Rune Prison comes down, the Overload will kill him. Flash over the wall from Kuve, takes him to safety. And looks like he'll be able to make it back underneath this tower. But Marin, ooh, does he want to go for this? Lands that electric harpoon. and that's going to send Kuvay packing back at the base for sure.
Kuvay may be ahead in CS, but he is losing every all-in trade that we see, so definitely not too much to worry there. Haru didn't have to use his kick because the Ash Arrow registered onto Malzahar, and that's why they came into this play. Turned into something of a geometry problem here. There were some angles going on as well, so the protractor meant there was no way for Kuro to get out. He falls down. So still even Achilleos, 1,000 gold is not much to speak about at 14 minutes.
No, no, not really. Things will get a bit more interesting, I'd like to think, once that Mountain Drake does come up. Because Cloud Drake picked up for Afrika, as mentioned, not going to be the most impactful at the moment. So when that Mountain Drake comes in, should have some contention over that. Kuvay is able to keep ahead in CS. He's keeping his head above the water for the time being, despite losing out on these trades.
And that was mostly
back in the lane with that Negatron.
It's mostly because of the early game, right? Mostly because he was taken out in the early game, had to play conservatively. Doesn't have any advanced vision on the red side jungle. You can see no blue wards anywhere near the Rift Herald or behind into the camps. So he's always kind of on his toes to be turret dive. Does have flash back up to say flash kick, like he was able to do earlier, but can't play as overextended as he wanted, and that's why Kuvay is going even despite every time the camera mouses over a trade. It's going the way of Rum.
Yep. And still opted in to that proto belt. He's had that completed for a bit of time now. Samsung.
Big fight time.
To the bottom lane. Gord changing, flashing forward. He's able to find Kramer with the stun, but
big equalizer.
The turn, that might have been a bit more than they could chew. That's going to be the Radiance coming through from Kara. Kuvay arriving. Four men stunned up with the Slicing Maelstrom, but he still goes down. Kramer finds the kill, and Ruler is swift to follow. Will that be a triple kill? No. Goes over to Kuro. Samsung committing way too hard for that turret. They're going to lose theirs in the bottom lane by the look of things, and they lose three members simultaneously. Afrika completely turned that one around.
Samsung and probably the viewers at home got baited by the fact that the cannon was on so many members.
Haru Kuro finds Kuro, is able to pick up yet another kill. So a bit of a consolation prize. They'll maintain the gold lead, but still lose a hell of a lot more than they would like.
And that's the thing. Marin teleported top. He realized he can get a lot of turret damage down. Kuvay had to teleport to bot lane, so they may actually lose this turret even though Rumble isn't fast. But coming back to my original point, this was with everyone roaming down. Marin is in the right place at the right time. Doesn't need to teleport. The equalizer is beautiful. And then, okay, Cosmic Radiance hits. You see Cannon, and Cannon's like, I can get a five-man ultimate. The exhaust. Exactly at the right moment. Kuvay, not level 11, and the damage is so backloaded that basically they get stunned. Everyone from Samsung walks towards them because they were running away before, and that means everyone's in the equalizer damage. Everyone's funneling up. So Kuvay's positioning actually baited Afrika, baited Samsung into taking more losses than they would have had to.
Yep, and now it's just going to be a 1,000 gold lead here for Samsung. Good on Haru to identify that he could go in and kill Kuro on the backside of that fight. Definitely a bit of a reprieve for them, but both of those bottom tier 1 turrets going down. Marin not able to finish off the one on top, but it's dangerously low. If Spirit comes up for a dive, they could kill Kuvay and that turret very quickly.
So they're going to be building Rylai's as well. The build path has changed a little bit, but looks like it's going to be Rylai's on Rumble. Still Asgard on Rumble. After this changes to slow, the harpoon slow isn't relevant, so the fact that he still gets 20% slow on his Q means that he doesn't lose out. Obviously, the item itself doesn't have the same gold efficiencies, but does fit Rumble if you want to build it. Could also go in other directions. I guess Protobelt became the item build after Marin was last seen in Korea playing that Rumble, so there's an outside chance he'll go for that second, but heavily expecting the Rylai's.
See, Haru. Heading up to the top lane, Slicing Maelstrom is there for Kuvay, as well as the Dragon's Rage. Haru's still hovering around. Wasn't
spotted coming in.
Yeah, that ward was thrown down after the fact. Now he's spotted, though. And a Freak of Freaks in the bottom lane. They get a heck of a lot of damage in onto that tier 2.
Yeah, they had a feeling Lee Sin was topside, so they knew they were good in terms of numbers. Kramer also gets free time on mid lane turret because he was unaccountable.
Oh, Ash Arrow comes out, not going to connect. Haru getting rooted by that corrupting arrow. And now has to dash to safety. Spirit did pop Ragnarok, so they do get that big ultimate away from the Olaf.
But no Crystal Arrow, no Kennen teleport, so They can walk up and take some shots on turret, but now they think better of it. Kramer's build is still very much in its building block phase. He doesn't even have his Zeal item started yet.
Interesting to see that he goes for the Essence Reaver and not even the Tear of the Goddess. We've seen, I mean, we saw Vera's ADC yesterday, and the Mana Moon was very much an item of choice. But Kramer, again, doesn't really conform to standard build paths.
I didn't actually see his build max order. If you don't go Tear, you can just max E first. The original...
The Hail of Arrows?
The Blade of Ruin King build, when we finally do see it, is the original Varus build, which was max W, so EW, into Q last. Leave Q at one point, just kind of for scouting. So if you don't go Tear, you can just not have the same poke, but still be relevant. Again, that's mostly Blade of the Ruin King, so perhaps he's going to be conservative with his Qs.
Looks like it might be Essence Reaver into Hurricane.
Hurricane pass, not a surprise. It feels like every AD carry is itemizing Hurricane. I even heard there's a new Jhin build where Hurricane's one of the items, so...
How does that work with this fourth shot?
Every auto attack is one, so even though you don't get a fourth shot every two autos, no.
Gotcha.
But Essence Reaver, double Zeal item is a new build people are trying out.
Interesting. Well, people are experimenting. I mean, I suppose that's how we ended up with that Ziggs bot lane as well.
Some of them are abandoned experiments. Jhenaer's last AD carry now over at Paris Saint-Germain. Pilot. Loved to go Rageblade Tristana. That was a thing he tried. I think he went Rageblade Ashe as well. He loved Rageblade, that man.
I mean, we've seen Rageblade Tristana multiple times. I mean, that made its way into NA as well.
It's something. It was a Q-Max, so... It's just going to be more conservative because it does take multiple auto attacks to get back the mana compared to the increased max mana of the tier.
Well, Samsung have definitely pumped the brakes a bit. Weren't able to take that Mountain Drake. Did go over to Afrika, so they have two in their inventory at the moment. And they're just barely under 1,000 gold ahead, Kuve. He pops forward. That Frodo belt gets a bit of damage in onto Marin. But now Koro arriving in the top lane. They're going to be looking to knock down this turret. Crown has roamed his way over. Still might not be enough to hold on to this. They see Tucson waiting in the wings. I think
doesn't
he just
know.
Has to let this one go.
Doesn't know he's in a ward, but Marin has been sitting on these items a long time. He's probably got quite a lot of gold here, so doesn't want to bait his team.
Koro's waiting to throw out. Oh, never mind. I already threw out the arrow. Just didn't connect. Didn't see it until it was flying off the screen.
He's in the ethers now.
Hits that dragon, it's like flying off in the back of the map.
Is it beyond Shyvana from yesterday?
That was a bit of a flunk, if there ever was one spirit. He's going to get locked up, hasn't popped the Ragnarok yet, so showing some restraint there.
That was actually cool, he actually popped Cosmic Radiance as the ultimate was channeling, so they came in invulnerable, but didn't do anything from it. So the cool factor definitely outweighed the usefulness, but that's an interaction to think about for the future.
I feel like that's how most things work, at least with products, is the cool factor outweighs the usefulness.
But you can see like a pre-planned Cosmic Radiance, Bastion Link, Massive Dazzle instantly with everyone invulnerable work once upon
a
time.
Sounds great in theory. Marin though, overheated, in a bit of a rough spot, just going to get kicked right into the wall so he can't go anywhere. And Crown will finish him off for the killing blow, so nice little roam down, and what do you know, Marin was overextended.
A little bit different outside laning phase. Had flash, but Haro was smart and just get the mini stun against the wall. Don't go for any hijinks. Didn't need to go for a ward hop. The kill's not the most consequential, though. They'll get a bit of information around the red side jungle, but this game is probably going to be played a bit more around Baron. Although, as I say that, there is a Drake spawning in 50 seconds, so any advanced vision you get might serve to guarantee this Drake more and more over to Samsung.
Which is definitely that they definitely want. Double Mountain Drake for Afrika. Be pretty bad if you're Samsung. They've already been able to knock down two turrets in the bottom and top side of the map, and the mid is pretty much dead anyway. So they're pretty close to getting rid of all of those tier ones. So if Afrika are able to get that Mountain Drake, it's going to be rough times for Samsung. Ruler, looking like he's going to have to back off. They could just dive him if they really wanted to. This turret's two hits from dead. So they'll just go ahead and break this one off.
Of the Rylai's as the rush, or second item for Marin. Yep, spent a lot of time taking that top turret. There is three outer turrets down for Samsung, who haven't really been able to dent the mid and top lane too much.
And now Afrika Freaks with that turret dead, they could just kite back down to the dragon. It's what Samsung would have to expect is being taken. They do throw out that orb and get the dissonance off. Onicore JJ knocks him down to about half HP.
Need some sweepers as well. They only have a single one.
Oh, boy.
Bouncer, Samsung.
Samsung, they're really running a bit of a gamble
here. We don't
see
the health. It's at 4,000 now. They might just get it.
Afrika Freaks are roaming up. Can they get there in time? It's going low. Can they kill him on the exits? That's going to be the red carpet thrown down. Tuzin flashing forward. Is able to find Core JJ. They take him out.
Here's Olaf.
Oh, boy. Spirit sprinting forward, jumping onto Kube, who flashes away. But a big shockwave comes through. Ruler goes down. Kube on the other side of the fight gets burned out by Marin with a flame spitter. Crown trying to run his way out, gets silenced. The Malefic Vision's ticking down, and the axe flies straight and true from Spirit. Four members dead on the side of Samsung. They get the Baron, but only one person's retaining it. Afrika Freaks completely win that trick.
There's something magical about that Righteous Glory Ghost Olaf. As you said in champs, that the perfect ball carrier gets a really big wombo ult. Lot of gold over to Samsung. Baron no longer an objective. The Drake, they're not rushing towards that either. Haru wants another answering kill.
Just kicks out onto Tuzin, doesn't have the Sonic Wave. Had to use it to get in there, and that's going to be the tier 2 going down in mid and top. Afrika Freaks profiting so much from that near ace.
Oh, get my breath back. Samsung, you know, another thing you can do with Cosmic Radiance. This is really cute. Didn't even get Lee Sin in there instantly, but it's early enough in the game. They were posturing towards the Baron, so towards the Dragon, and then obviously Afrika is surprised with what happened. Tuzin gets a kill, and if it's just Core JJ, happy time to Samsung. But Turbo Olaf walks in. Tether range is still there. Big wombo ult. Nowhere for Ruler to go, nowhere for Crown to go. And they get two inner turrets as well and cancel Baron buff on everyone except Lee Sin. Really hard to say how much of a victory that is for Afrika, but a victory nonetheless. And Spirit, feeling pretty good. Some catharsis after a weak game 2 performance from Spirit.
Yeah, I mean, one hell of a turnaround. Seems like Olaf might be one of those things you have to target ban away from Spirit. I mean, thinking back, I believe LS is, he put out a tier list just a couple days ago, and Olaf, much to his upset, put it in, you know, B tier selection for Olaf. But Spirit's really pushing it to be an S tier in this game.
Yeah, especially when Courage continues to be toned down a little bit and Courage junglers are less in vogue. I think there really is a spot for Olaf. He's one keystone that really fits him away from being, I think, A tier or a really top tier jungler. But in the right hands, and especially when you're looking to dominate 1v1 jungle matchups, like Nidalee used to be able to out-duel every enemy jungler, Olaf can often do that. And then you get games where game one where you walk in, his level 1 is really, really powerful, and you can dictate the game. So you're right. This now becomes one of those bans where, especially on blue side, why not ban Olaf?
Oh, Haru gets the kick in, but he just puts him closer to his teammates, and not quite the angle that he wanted. The flash by Marin to make sure that he didn't get shoved into the awaiting arms of Samsung's team.
Looks like Abyssal Scepter might be next item for Marin. Not really many options for non-magic mantle for a non-tank like the Rumble. Not going to be a spirit visage, you wouldn't think. So
Guardian Angel.
Guardian Angel is a possibility, but Abyssal Scepter was.
He had the gold to just buy it out.
Marin's buys is so greedy. Sat on Ruby Crystal Amp Tome for a long time, bought up a straight-up Rylai's. Non-magic mantle and Abyssal Scepter's not a trivial amount of gold either. But, you know, he's going to be another one that's going to get in short range. And this is the build where he's like, okay, I flashed before. I don't need Azonias. I'm going to get in, overheat, put down the ult. If I die, I'm going to take half health bars of other people with me.
Well, Freak have certainly gotten control of this game, but they still have to be a bit concerned with Kuve. You know, building the AP on that cannon, there is that potential that he could get that massive slicing maelstrom down onto multiple members of Afrika and really turn the fight around.
But there's another step to that, Achilleos. The famous play where Smeb exploded 3-4 members at Worlds. This doesn't happen anymore because the damage is so backloaded. If your flash is up, you will evade probably about 2/3 of the damage after the stun duration goes down.
All right, so slicing maelstrom into a 5-man dazzle from Core JJ.
Sure, but that's the thing. It's like, if there was the setup CC, but yeah, it could still happen. But like when the setup CC is a sick dazzle, I don't know. Like, I guess it's possible.
I think that would at least earn Core JJ MVP from one play alone. if he was able to pull that
so
off.
So what I want to see is the Bastion is onto Lee Sin. All five members of Afrika are next to a wall. Kicks them into the wall for the mini stun and then dazzles as the Slicing Maelstrom is going. That's the very achievable way to get the sick Slicing Maelstrom damage.
Sounds perfect.
Sounds optimistic.
All right, go ahead, Samsung. Do it.
Stand next to that wall, Afrika. Also, Olaf, forget to ult.
I mean, when you're, you know, when there's no poppy in the game, you're more likely to stand next to a wall.
You are right.
You kind of sleep on that. I mean, sometimes when there is a poppy in the game, you still sleep on that. We saw that yesterday.
People forget that the terrain, especially around mid lane, the corner of the entrance into the river for Baron Vision, is, as we see on our screen here, is definitely a poppy favorite.
Yep.
Stadium here, the OGNE stadium, is really quiet. You know, both sides are fans.
It's tense.
It's a tense atmosphere because although I say that at the end of the season, you know, people won't necessarily remember who won this game, it doesn't take many wins and losses to separate finals opponents. As Haru opens up with ult, no one else is around right now.
Oh yeah, Tucson throws down that nether grass. We can see the Radiance coming through. Kuve is a bit chunked out. He uses the proto belt just to create a little bit more distance.
Rumble's in base. Mahn looking for a purchase. Probably just going to walk up now. If Mahn had teleported, there was no way for Ryze to match him. But not to be. Get a big ultimate out in the Cosmic Radiance. And the CDR is not that high from Core JJ, so still pretty decent cooldown there. But Kramer's flash is down. That's one thing we might have missed there, which could be consequential. Because Varus, of course, mobile AD carry. So Lee Sin certainly has an obvious target for the next 4 minutes or so.
Afrika Freaks did get some good vision deep inside the jungle of Samsung for this Baron that's about to spawn in about 30 seconds. It's also going to be another Dragon, just under a minute. Cloud Drake, so definitely not going to be the priority at this stage of the game. More of an afterthought. Kuve, though, getting jumped on by Mahn, throws down the Equalizer. He'll get the stun and flash away, but Mahn, he might put the Chiesis one out. Meanwhile, here comes
Spirit, Olaf,
wrapping around from the other side, throws out the Smite. And they are able to snipe him with that Electro Harpoon. But, you know, Haru got a blue buff, so that's good.
The crowd's laughter will do enough as a response to that particular point. It was in the opposite quadrant that Afrika wanted to pick. A pick around the Baron buff might have meant the Baron could be starred. They may still look.
But, I mean, you get rid of that massive AoE stun from Kuve fighting inside the pit, so that's still going to be a pretty good look if you're a Freak of
But
Freaks.
It's the time, Achilleos. The 40 seconds when it's someone right next to Baron is consequential, but when, you know, by the time they get there, it's only 15 seconds, the teleport can come through.
This is really, okay. The crowd's gonna go in. Overheat does come through from Mahn, so he has to just run away. Has that blast cone to take him to safety. Crown,
wow, Crown really wants it.
The wall. Yeah, he wants to try to take this one out. Looks like he will be able to win this trade quite handily. Mahn flashing out, gets the slow from the Electro Harpoon, the speed up from the scrap shield. Meanwhile, Baron goes down. Spirit finds it, and Ground can't come up with a kill. So all five members from Afrika Freaks will be able to maintain that Baron buff.
And we didn't even talk about Baron being taken down the whole time. No picture-in-picture. What you doing, OGN? But regardless, Baron buff is a big prize. Crown wanted to make sure that the teleport user didn't have Baron because it's always the most consequential. Mahn walks bottom, has Baron buff, pushes even faster, and has the minions. Then suddenly the numbers will really start to tell you. Haru came for the contest, and Tucson did this in game one. He does it again in game three. Suppression means no smite, no way to get over the wall. It's a targeted ability as well. You don't often think about the peeling Malzahar ult, but very relevant in that case, around specifically the Baron as an objective.
Yep. And Cloud Drake does come through. And now, Afrika Freaks with all this smooth speed that they have acquired.
Hey, Olaf appreciates it.
Oh, for sure.
Olaf definitely hits that like button on Cloud Drake. It's just Olaf and Freak. Those are the two people.
Very lonely fan page for Cloud Drake.
Hey, it got better. It's pretty good now. Let's be real. I'm much more of an ocean hater myself.
Really?
Yeah, the first one. If it's the first one and you take it pre-10 minutes, sure. But I don't know. Ocean's not that great.
Again, like a very CG situation, it could work out decently well. But all right. Either way, speaking of Siege, Afrika Freaks grouping up now into the bottom side of the map. There's four members here with Mahn rotating up to the top side to get that wave moving forward. And the Wave clear here from Samsung. It's going to be rough. They have to rely on Crown, really, to try to mark as best as he can. Cosmic Radiance comes down.
Not been in love with the Cosmic Radiance usage.
Yeah, not really sure about the Taric in general, honestly.
Taric's really good in the late game. If you get the right ult, there's a lot of ifs. There's so many conditional factors to make a melee champion already work. It's not Tahm Kench, where Devour is pretty straightforward. Much longer cooldown. So I don't know about forcing the Taric. Kind of reminds me of some teams forcing the mid lane Echo so far this week. Can be good in the right circumstances. Doesn't need to be good in multiple circumstances.
Yeah, that was a worrisome one that we saw yesterday. But another turret, another inhibitor likely to go down. Spirit sprinting in. That command protect. Mitigate a little bit more damage. Ruler doing what he can to hit these minions, but he can't really walk up to get the majority of the wave. Piero comes out.
Big Equalizer!
Crown. He gets taken out. Equalizer is well helping that. Big Shockwave will help work down as Kuvay and Crown fall. Tucson does go down to the side of Afrika Freaks, but I think they're going to be quite all right with that exchange in the end. They want to stick around. Marn has the TP. Spirit's still here with his Guardian Angel. Do they want to go for the end? Looks like it's just going to be getting the waves, moving back into the base. Taking their time with this one. 30 seconds left on Kuvay and Crown.
Yeah, Marin's looking to wait to teleport onto a minion just to help with this siege. 25 seconds plus on two members. Freaka want to end it now.
Yeah, it does look that way. TP coming through to keep the minion alive. And the turret already falling. The first one goes down. A Freaka Freaks looking to close this out. 340 minutes. Poor JJ not going to find anything. Spirit just running straight onto Ruler's face. Still has the GA up. Takes him out. The Shockwave back up off cooldown. They find Haru. That's going to be the game. Afrika Freaks on their debut. Spirit and Marin both back in Korea come out on top.
What a big story for the Afrika Freaks. It was a tough ask to face a Samsung team that had already played once on stage, that already just won IEM Gyeonggi the last tournament before LCK Spring started. But they take down the victory. Spirit can smile after a woeful game too. Marin had a great series. We saw the best of Marin in this series. We saw some frustration as well. And we answered the question, okay, they can snowball a game and win it. They'll lose a game too. How will they rebound from losing that game too? The veteran status clearly helped them. Didn't look like Marin was rustled. Spirit put on a vintage performance on the Olaf in the final game. And Samsung probably thought this was going to be the season where their regular season form would match what they showed at Worlds, what they showed in the offseason. And so far, they've played six games. We're not sure who their starting jungler is, and now they're only 1-1.
Yeah, I mean, the starting jungler is going to be a really big question, because that's going to be the first loss suffered by Haru.
Because the question
becomes...
I mean,
he still played fairly decently, but just became rough. I don't know.
And the question becomes, Haru's 3-1, Ambition 0-2. How often can you start Ambition if you're not picking up that first victory? Because 3-1 is still good, but 3-1 has only contributed to one match win, one match loss, because they're starting so slowly.
Yeah. All right, well, really nicely done by Afrika Freaks.
And I'm jazzed, Achilleos, because, okay, we haven't seen Kongdu Monster, but we're getting the confirmation of what everyone suspected when these rosters that were coming together. This is going to be the season where working out the victors, working out the losers, it's going to be so much more difficult because a lot of these teams raised their personnel, the macro players coming along with it, that'll develop over time. And picking the winner of LCK Spring, easy to say SKT, but there's quite a few other names that have to be in the discussion.
Well, I mean, you mentioned Kongdu Monster not having seen them. They want to come out with a bang on this first series because just on Sunday, they do have to play against SK Telecom. So they want to have a strong showing, maybe instill a little bit of fear, a little bit of wavering in SK Telecom's confidence.
But the confidence is, we have to talk about is a Freak of Freaks. Marin, coming back from a woeful year, winning a series means so much. Spirit, coming away from a couple years away, it means so much. And that man, Spirit, is your MVP here. I think especially given just how much he struggled in Game 2, his performance here, I think he was most under the magnifying glass in Game 3. And 209, no deaths on Olaf, a hard commit champion. Pass marks for Spirit.
Yeah, I mean, really good kill contribution rate as well. 69% to finish things out. And, I mean, once he got that Righteous Glory, it was just hilarious to watch him zipping forward, but just landing these axes consistently, helping get these kills.
But it's not the mechanics of this fight, it's Kilios. It's why are they there at 5 minutes? Why so much aggression?
Yeah.
A because, I mean, it got punished in so many different ways. Again, there was a different game where, you know, they didn't go for such big plays, but it's something that's said about how all these highlight plays are Samsung going for targets.
Yeah. And the Taric, yet again, Cosmic Radiance, you know, gets onto four people, but they're not fighting actively, so they're not really getting any profit from that big ultimate. And Cuve, despite his best efforts locking up multiple members, and Freaks is still able to roll out on top of them, and this is the big sprint coming in from Spirit right here.
Oh, look how fast he is. Ghost, Righteous Glory. Hey, maybe even speed up on the Dissonance. Really nice stuff. Nowhere for Ruler to go. You know, you play with fire. Olaf was always the natural predator of an Ashe, because Ashe, sure, got the slows, got the poke, but doesn't have an answer to Ragnarok. Yeah. Big, big win for Freak Freaks.
Absolutely. Great way to start things off from them. We're going to see them later on Sunday as
Watch
well.
Watch for this ult here. Again, he was exhausted as a Tucson. Predator on these exhausts, but not a lot of damage coming onto these members. I feel like Marin's definitely a bit more on track with how to use Kennen in the new version, because I remain to be convinced that AP Kennen has the reliability of what it brought before.
Mm-hmm. Well, now a Freak of Freaks starting things off with that 2-1 victory. Might